district court's decision granting defendant's motion to dismiss the second amended complaint is presented under a standard of de novo review. The facts alleged in the second amended complaint comply with all the elements of securities fraud under the pleading standards of the PSLRA and the federal rules. The two primary issues on appeal are the issues of falsity and scienter. This is a case where the sum is greater than the parts. And when you look at all of the corroborating evidence, plaintiffs have plausibly alleged that the statements defendants made throughout the class period were false or misleading within the context in which they were made. There's no dispute, and all the evidence points to the fact that thrombosis rates started rising in 2011, or even higher in 2012, rising to all the way over 8% in 2013. Plaintiffs allege 8%. Defendants sometimes say 5%, sometimes they say 6%. That's a factual issue. But all the corroborating evidence based on defendants' monitoring of the data, they admitted that back in 2008 they told the FDA that they were going to collect post-surveillance marketing data on all pump thrombosis rates, and it was required that they report that data to the FDA. So they were following the data. They admitted throughout the class period that they had a, quote, earlier look on the data, that they were looking at thrombosis rates, and everything pointed that rates were maintained at that 2 to 3% of what they were during preclinical trial rates. Defendants even stated 2 days after the New England Journal of Medicine study was disclosed that they had performed a, quote, extensive analysis of the increase in rates and had, quote, closely monitored the rates. Plaintiffs also allege that not only were defendants collecting all this data, but that clinicians and the FDA became so concerned with rising rates. In 2012, the FDA launched an investigation through Intermex, the very entity that the defendants were following to determine the rise in rates. In early 2013, clinicians stated that they specifically reached out to defendants and told them there's this deadly rise in rates, we're really concerned, and they said that Thoratec was cooperating in getting all the data for them. So the lower court, didn't analyze all of that data. They picked out a few pieces of evidence. They picked out a piece of evidence of the MAUD data, which we also allege to establish rates. Now, the MAUD data is a database that's...
Are you really alleging rates or events?
Rates.
But did you have all of the information for rates? I thought you had events and then sales figures, and you kind of have to piece them together. You didn't have how many they were selling, did you?
There are, yes, to answer your question, yes, the defendants disclosed on a few occasions how many units were implanted. So we do have a chart in the complaint also comparing that. But we, federal courts around the country have allowed plaintiffs to extrapolate rates based on the SAEs in the MAUD data. But again, this is just one minor piece of information because the defendants all along were touting rates and talking about rates. And
in the period before the studies came out, is your theory that because they were still talking about rates, there was like an omission, a misleading omission? I'm wondering whether that's the core of your theory or whether your theory is that the statements were false in and of themselves. Like, if they just stayed silent in that period, would they have been okay?
If they didn't talk about rates at all? Yes, they would have been okay. But they put rates in issues, and the market and the investors were fully focused on rates, which is evidenced by the analysts throughout the entire class period. Every time the defendants talked about rates, when the New England Journal of Medicine study came out, and then at the final disclosure in August, analysts came out and said, oops, we thought that rates weren't a big deal, but now that they are, we recommend that you go buy the one competitor product that's on the market, Heartware. And that's another allegation that we have in the complaint that was ignored by the district court. interesting throughout the class period. So defendants knew that once they started disclosing that rates were increasing, they were going to lose their share of the market. And with respect to Scienter, and now in this case, falsity and Scienter overlap greatly. Aside from collecting the data, monitoring the data, admitting defendants Burbach and Harris admitted that the rates had risen in 2011, 2012, 2013. Now Harris says they went up to 6%. Burbach said our rates closely monitor Intermax, which one of the Intermax studies showed 5%. One said they reported to Thoratec that it was 6.4%. Those are all issues of fact, but the point remains that the statements that they made, that rates maintained at 2 to 3% were false and misleading in context, and that they knew or recklessly turned a blind eye because they have one of two scenarios. Either they collected all the data, had the data, knew that rates were not 2 to 3% and told the market they were, or they followed the Intermax data, collected all the data, and didn't do anything about it. Now, we know that that's either scenario, we've established Scienter, and the fact of the matter remains is that in early 2013, the clinician specifically told Thoratec, rates are rising, they're deadly, clinicians are concerned, and can you please help us gather information? Now, aside from having evidence of knowledge, plaintiffs have also alleged the poor operations theory, which is a viable theory in the Ninth Circuit, reasonable versus below, and in other cases. And when you view this complaint and the allegations holistically, along with the allegations that defendants knew of the increased rates, had access clearly to the rates data, and because HeartMate was Thoratec's leading product, and the market...
How long do you claim they knew the data?
Since the beginning of the class period, 2011.
Until when?
Until through the end of the class period and then some. Because when the first partial disclosure occurred in November 2013, that was the New England Journal of Medicine study, they had already been specifically told, aside from collecting data, that rates had risen to a deadly rising rate, morbidity and mortality had increased. And then after that time period, from that time period till the end of the class period, they continued to hide the ball from investors and the market. In fact, they came out and said after that period, Burbach, that rates are low. We're monitoring Intermax, which is true. They were monitoring Intermax, but they were downplaying. And in fact, they went so far as to say that sales would not be impacted by concerns over thrombosis rates. This is after the New England Journal of Medicine study was disclosed, and then just a few months later in August, sure enough, they disclosed that sales were severely impacted by the New England Journal of Medicine study and the fact that clinicians were very concerned over rising rates, and the stock dropped 25% in one day. And on that disclosure, analysts came out and said, oh, we misunderstood what the company said back in November, and now we were downgrading, and we suggest you go buy hardware because clearly the problems with thrombosis rates here are not going away.
But the district court divided the time periods into segments. If we think that there were enough allegations of misrepresentations on one of the time segments, but not the other, like say before the studies, but not after the studies, what should we do? Do you accept the division of the time periods?
I understand what you're saying, and I accept that there are two time periods in this class, in the class period, one before the disclosure of the New England Journal of Medicine study, which is a partial disclosure, and then the final August disclosure. I submit that the falsities went on through the whole class period, but if the court were to cut it off, the plaintiffs still have a viable cause of action.
And then you would just have a smaller class period. Is that what would happen then?
Correct. Correct.
You want to save the rest of your time?
Yes, please. Thank you.
Thank you.
definition of what it is we're talking about when we talk about securities fraud. The gist of a securities fraud claim is supposed to be that the defendants made statements about the company or its business. At the time they spoke, they had information that was inconsistent with or undermined in some meaningful way the statements they made. And the stock dropped when the market learned what the defendants had known all along. That is, in a nutshell, what a securities fraud case is supposed to look like. The problem with this case is plaintiffs do not actually allege what information the defendants had on any of the specific dates where the challenge statements were made. They do not allege specific facts showing that the information known to the defendants when they spoke was inconsistent with what they said, and they do not allege facts showing that when the market heard about the New England Journal of Medicine article, that the market was learning something the defendants had known all along. And so for that reason, the complaint fails both for purposes of falsity and scienter, and it also fails for purposes of loss causation. Now, I think conceptually the challenge statements fall into three buckets. There are the two time periods that the court has alluded to, and then in the latter time period, there are two categories of statements, roughly speaking. Some statements talking about thrombosis rates, principally talking about the differences between the New England Journal of Medicine article and the Intermex study. And then there's a separate category of statements that are statements of the financial guidance, the forward-looking financial guidance or reaffirmations of the guidance, which I think are analytically distinct. But most of the allegations in the complaint, most of what you heard here today, I think related to the statements before November 27, 2013, so I'll focus my time there as well, unless the court has questions about that. One of the things that's very important for the court to keep in mind here is, on appeal, the plaintiffs are challenging seven statements that relate to thrombosis rates before November 27, 2013, seven statements. And we glean that from their opening brief at pages 18 to 19, note 2. That's where they identify which of the statements they're still challenging, and they list some statements they are no longer challenging for purposes of appeal. All seven of these statements took place over a nine-month period of time, beginning on May 11, 2011, and ending on February 16, 2012. Now, you see repeatedly in the briefs, and you heard repeatedly here today, lots of references to things that clinicians were saying to Thoratec in 2013. That's totally irrelevant. It's over a year after the last of the challenge statements that relates directly to thrombosis rates. What matters for purposes of falsity and scienter is what did the defendants know about thrombosis rates between May 11, 2011 and February 16, 2012. I may have spoken earlier and said February 8th. February 16th, 2012 is the last of the challenge statements that speaks to thrombosis rates. Now, plaintiffs have not alleged any facts showing that anyone, whether inside or outside of Thoratec, had even observed an increase in thrombosis rates during that period between May of 2011 and February of 2012. Again, you hear repeated references to concerns expressed in 2013, but no information suggested that anyone anywhere had actually observed an increase in thrombosis rates during the period in which the challenge statements were made. Plaintiff's primary source for saying repeatedly it's undisputed that the rates were raising is the New England Journal of Medicine article that was published on November 27th, as well as a study published by Intermax that same day. Intermax had also published some preliminary data on September 6th of 2013. What plaintiffs have not alleged, though, are any facts showing that the data reflected in the New England Journal article or in the Intermax study was reflecting data that was known to any of the defendants when they made the challenge statements between May of 11 and February of 12. Both of these studies evaluated data up through early 2013, or at least the end of 2012. So, in other words, by their very nature, these two studies included data that was not even available, events that had not yet even occurred when the challenge statements were made. We know, for example, that the Intermax study wasn't even underway until the spring of 2013. And it's not clear from the pleading when the work began on the New England Journal of Medicine article, but we know it began sometime long after the last of the challenge statements. I think that's a reasonable inference given the data they used in the study. Plaintiff's complaint includes a number of other very vague and very conclusory allegations about information that was supposedly available to defendants during the class period, but they don't come close to identifying any specific contrary information available to the defendants when they spoke. Plaintiffs repeat this language in various forms throughout the briefing, and again here today. I think one of the best examples is at page 44 of their opening brief. They have some bullet points that lay out what I assume are some of their favorite allegations, and they characterize them in the way that I think is, they presumably think is most favorable to them. But I think they're actually most notable for what they don't say. For example, and I'm just running through that list on page 44 of their brief in order. Plaintiffs claim there were physicians on site at Thoratec examining clinical data. That's what they say. They don't say anything about what that clinical data showed, when it showed it, or even that the clinical data that's being referenced in this allegation has anything to do with thrombosis. There are a number of other types of adverse events that are closely studied. This allegation says nothing about clinical data about thrombosis, much less data showing an increase during the period when the defendants were speaking about it. This allegation doesn't even talk about heart rate, too. Plaintiffs claim that the company performed post-approval studies. They don't say anything about when those studies were prepared, when they were completed, what they showed, or when they showed it. There's no basis for any inference that the post-approval studies put the company on notice of an increase in thrombosis rates. Plaintiffs argue that the defendants knew about reports of serious adverse events or SAEs related to HeartMate 2.
The complaint in paragraphs like 78 through 85 takes at least events and sales data and extrapolates to try to go all the way back to 2010 and 11, which would be in the time period you're talking about. I think part of their argument is that the company knew about the events and would have been calculating these rates themselves, and it's implausible to say that they didn't know that there was an increase. So what's your response to that?
So there are several responses to that. I agree that's what the complaint alleges, and frankly the plaintiffs criticize the district court for focusing on the allegations about the MOD data, but that is actually what the plaintiffs cite as evidence or allegations that the statements were false. The MOD data and the sales data doesn't get you there for the following reason. When the defendants were speaking about thrombosis rates, they were talking about clinical studies that express thrombosis rates in terms of events per patient year. This is a factor that takes into account not just how many devices and how many events of thrombosis, but how long the devices were in place. Right, so for purposes of that measure, if I have one of these devices implanted and I experience a thrombosis in the first month, that's very different from getting the device implanted and having a thrombosis after 2 or 3 years of extended or hopefully improved life, right? So the thrombosis rates that were discussed during the class period are thrombosis rates expressed in terms of events per patient year. The New England Journal of Medicine article and the Intermax study, which the plaintiffs claim together revealed at least some of the truth about increased rates, also express the increased rates in terms of thrombosis events per patient year. Plaintiff's allegations about the MOD data and the sales data does not measure events per patient year. It can't measure events per patient year. And so one of the things the district court correctly concluded is, because this isn't even measuring the same thing, it doesn't render statements about events per patient year false or misleading.
But does that just encourage, if we agree with that, does that just encourage the company not to do studies? I mean, if you have, and they're at least alleging that there was information about increased events and increased events, and so you say, okay, we're just going to close our eyes and not do the relevant calculation so we don't have one that contradicts it. I mean, is that what you're asking us to rule is okay?
I'm not asking you to rule that's okay. I don't think it's okay, and I frankly don't think that this court needs to allow a claim of securities fraud to go forward to guard against that possibility. There is a ton of regulation about monitoring data and performing post-approval studies and monitoring device performance. That's regulated heavily by the FDA. We don't need to put these defendants at risk of a frivolous securities fraud claim in order to encourage companies to perform studies. And the truth is, there are studies going on all the time for devices like this. This device was a major advance in treatment of people who are suffering from advanced heart failure. It took people who are likely to die very soon and extended their lives or improved the quality of their lives. It's being studied constantly. Plaintiffs omit almost all of this from the data, but it's
well, do you have a study that is in that in-between period of the 2011 and 12 period where you can say, look, we were doing these studies and it showed that on the relevant measure everything was the same and that's why we were truthful? Or do we have this big gap?
So I don't think we have a gap. So let me, but the record is limited because the plaintiffs get to choose what's in their complaint. But I would refer the court to our supplemental excerpts of the record beginning at page 34. What this is, in the complaint, the plaintiffs say that in August of 2014, about the same time they announced the earnings miss, that plaintiffs say finally revealed the full truth. The FDA also...
Could you just say the ER page again? Because I got to a signature page.
All right, it should begin at SER 34.
Okay.
And what this is the FDA, in the wake of all this information coming out about increases in thrombosis rates, the FDA directed Thoratec to change the labeling for the device. The labeling is supposed to include information about risks of the device, that sort of thing, and it is very closely scrutinized by the FDA. It's heavily regulated. So this document is the revised label mandated by the FDA to apprise clinicians and patients about the risks associated with this device. If you look at this FDA-approved revised label, there are discussions of a wide range of clinical trials, both pre- and post-approval. I believe some of those trials do encompass the time period in question. There are trials going on continuously, and they're cited, some of them at SER 50. Some of them are cited at SER 51.
Can you point us to what part of this FDA label is supposed to show that you're right about this?
Yes, I'd be happy to. So at SER 50, for example, there is a chart looking at various clinical trials to measure pump thrombosis. The one that includes the most recent data is the third of the three that are listed there in the middle of the page, which says Worldwide Clinical Experience, footnote 3. Okay. And this covers data from 2005 to 2013. It's 11,647 implants. You see there the percentage of confirmed thrombosis rate is actually 2.9. This is the FDA telling Thoratec what they need to tell people about thrombosis.
But it also says suspected or confirmed 6.4.
I understand. But when the defendants were speaking about rates of 2 to 3%, they're talking about confirmed, not suspected.
This gets to the omission point. I mean, is that clear from the statements that that's what they're talking about?
I think it's clear from the statements they're talking about because when they're making these statements, they are referencing specific studies that are public. It's all public information. This isn't information that Thoratec itself controls. Right? There are other entities out there studying these things and continually publishing reports, and that's why I wanted to show the court these pages because they reference some of those. We also asked for judicial notice of a number of slides that go along with the transcripts of the defendants making some of the statements that are challenged. And those slides also reference a number of studies, and they show that studies are going on continuously. So
Thoratec has this data that's being collected on an ongoing basis, right?
Thoratec has data, but we need to be careful about what this data means, but yes.
The data that eventually ends up being able to give you a percentage of confirmed or suspected. And my question is, where a company has that data, is there no way or inclination to be assessing it on an ongoing basis as opposed to waiting till the end of the years for a total composite look back that would give you statistical significance or whatever?
So I think the answer...
Real time versus...
Yeah, so plaintiffs allege no facts that suggest that you can biggest claim that this information was really important to everybody. It was important to the FDA. It was important to Intermact. It was important to the securities analysts. It was important to the company. It was important to clinicians. But there's a reason why Intermact wasn't able to publish even preliminary data going up through 2012 until September of 2013. And there's a reason why the New England Journal of Medicine, looking at data up through early 2013, wasn't able to publish any numbers until the end of November of 2013. If you look at the
Intermact. What's the reason? I mean, it's peer review or something. Maybe you wouldn't have that internally.
Well, so the study, if you can look at the studies, they are in the supplemental excerpts of the record. The Intermact study and the New England Journal article, I think, both talk about the extensive work they have to go through in order to confirm diagnoses of thrombosis. They talk about the fact that this is a difficult thing to diagnose accurately and consistently across different centers. The New England Journal article actually notes the fact that during the period covered by their study, the definition of thrombosis was changed, and the Intermact study actually used the newer definition that wasn't available to the New England Journal. So this isn't something like the weather, and you can just say, I'm tracking the daily temperature. This is an extraordinarily complex medical diagnosis that has to be made for each instance, and then the studies also show extensive statistical analysis to arrive at the numbers that the plaintiffs are acting like you can do in real time. The final point I want to make about this is the numbers the plaintiffs have used, the sales increases and increases in the number of events in the MOD data. That data was public throughout the class period. And yet the only people ever in the history of this device to use that data to try to draw conclusions about thrombosis rates are the plaintiffs' lawyers sitting in this courtroom. No one ever, as far as we know from the pleadings and the documents judicially noticed, has ever believed that you could draw reasonable and meaningful conclusions about thrombosis rates by comparing sales growth to the growth of events in the MOD database. And that's because that information is not complete enough to draw that conclusion. It's like saying, I can tell you that Buster Posey's batting average went down because he had fewer hits this year than he did last year. No, you can't. That doesn't give you enough information to say. And plaintiffs say this is a methodological dispute. It's not a methodological dispute. There may be different methods of calculating thrombosis rates. I'm sure there are. I can't figure them out. But I'm sure there are. This isn't a question about how you calculate thrombosis rates. They don't calculate a thrombosis rate. They can't because it's expressed in terms of events per patient.
But there's no... So they're using the proxy they have to try to say that studies that weren't available to them in between must have been showing this, right? And you are saying it's impossible to do those good studies, but so that's why they're using this other thing. Isn't that the response to the argument you're making?
Well, it may be the response, but that doesn't mean it adds up to securities fraud. I mean, the fact that the only data they were able to cobble together is the only data they can cobble together doesn't mean it actually shows anything is true or false. So I understand, yes, they claim they don't have any other data available. The truth is, you know, the other thing is that I think is important to keep in mind is studies are published. They're public. These institutions are constantly studying. They publish these things. They're out there. I can't come in here and show them to you because of the procedural posture we're in, but they're out there, and that's why we've tried to point to the slides where the speakers are talking about studies that are happening on an ongoing basis, and I'm pointing you to the FDA's mandated label, which talks about studies happening all the time. There are studies out there. Believe me, if there were a study...
So then what's the harm of letting you go into past this procedural stage and show those studies and get summary judgment?
That's an extraordinarily expensive proposition for the company, for its former directors and officers, for its D&O insurers. And the PSRA was put in place precisely to make sure that people were not exposed to that risk and that expense unless the complaint adequately pled a claim for securities fraud. And an absence of information is not a basis for accusing these people of lying to their shareholders. Plaintiffs have manufactured this absence of information. I can, you know, if as a procedural matter I can do it, I can show it to you. I think the record does reflect that there are studies going on continuously. And believe me, if there was a study that existed in 2011 or 12 that showed an increase in thrombosis rates, you'd be hearing about it. You're not. And I would submit the absence of information here is not suggestive of securities fraud. It's suggestive of precisely the opposite.
Thank you.
Thank
it's not about a group of scientists sitting in a room analyzing data. And my opponent is saying that, oh, they didn't know the data early on, and there's no way to analyze the data until the end. But they were telling the market, we analyzed the data. And the data shows a continued low thrombosis rate of 2 to 3%. I can take your honors through the exact statements of defendants Burbach and Harris throughout the class period. So in the absence of what your honor Freeland had asked me before, in the absence of defendants saying nothing, would there be a case here? No, but they were. They told the market, we're continually monitoring this data. The data is showing us 2 to 3% thrombosis rate, when in fact, either they had the data and it showed, as Burbach and Harris admitted, that the rates had increased 2011, 12, 13, or they didn't have the data, and then they were extremely reckless in telling the market that they had it, because the investors here rely on the price and they rely on the analyst to.
The process says that the last statement, which you now claim was in February 12th.
No, that's incorrect. That's for the first part of the class period. But we also allege a plethora of false statements after the New England Journal of Medicine came out in November of 2013 through the final disclosure in August of 2014, and in that time period, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 9 false statements in that class period, in that part of the class period. Absolutely. And what matters here is, have plaintiffs plausibly established a claim for securities fraud? Have they plausibly established falsity? Have they cogent and compellingly established scienter? And the answer overwhelmingly is yes. And when the courts are required to look at the evidence and the allegations holistically, it's not one piece of evidence. It's not just that, well, nobody uses MAW data. And the reason that plaintiffs included the MAW data in the second amended complaint is because the district court in the first amended complaint stated specifically, I don't think you've established rates. And one way to establish rates is to take the MAW data and compare it to the sales data or the unit volume data, and then you can establish rates. So plaintiffs did exactly that. But again, that's simply one small piece of the evidence. And you have, with counsel claiming that the defendants didn't know of increased rates, or they're not admitting that there were increased rates and that there's no data that there's increased rates. The Intermax study shows it. The New England Journal of Medicine study shows it. Burbach and Harris. Burbach made a statement December 4th, 2013, that's still within the class period, saying, if you look at that, there's a slight increase beginning in 2010, reading for 2011 and 12. And then in 2012, it's kind of a decreasing rate, which we know that part was a false statement because it increased all the way up to over 8% in 2013. And even by the Intermax data, who Intermax specifically stated they reported to defendants in January of 2013, that it was over 6%. You have Harris in December 2013 stating, Intermax has shown that the rate has increased from low single digits a few years ago gradually in the 2011-12 time frame to 6%. That's Harris, the CFO, admitting that. Then you have Burbach stating again in January 2014, our internal data is very consistent with Intermax, showing a small increase over time, which the last part is a lie because we know the increase was fourfold. And we know this because my opponent keeps referring to all these studies that were available on the market. That's simply not the case, and we know this because analysts were reporting constantly throughout the class period. And when the truth finally came out in August and the stock dropped 25%, the analyst specifically said, uh-oh, the problem with thrombosis rates is a lot worse than we thought. Well, why is it worse than they thought? Because they were relying on the company to tell them what the rates were. And they went so far as to say, we recommend that you buy Heartware now. Heartware was...
Thank you.
Thank you very much.